Hey, all right, welcome to How to Write a Novel. So I'm in Busan, South Korea now, and I'm glad to report things are going better. Seoul was quite a shit show. I didn't love it. And then I tried a random small town, Chechen, which you can see last episode, for deets. Deets is short for details. It's what all the kids said several decades ago. So Busan I really like because it's by the coast. It's the second biggest city. And it really does make a big difference. I mean, it's over 3 million people. That's a lot of people, but Seoul is over 10 million people. So this is a lot fucking smaller. And it just has this coastal feel that feels a lot like Fukuoka, Japan, which is across the water from here. There's a ferry that goes between them. Has that kind of feeling. It just seems cleaner and nicer and calmer. And also just the time of year is making a difference. I apparently have been here at literally the worst time for pollution. The dead of winter, November, December, January, February, the worst. So now that it's April, things are chilling out. Still not perfect. I mean, it's a little hazy today even. But by the standards of the area, it's pretty nice. And then, man, it's like the world is telling me not to go home. I was like, yeah, maybe at this point I'll just fly back to Toronto now, visit my Toronto friends who I haven't seen since before COVID, make my way back to my hometown. But a flight from Busan to fucking Toronto, a cheap one that still takes 31 hours and weird transfers and stuff, is $1,600. Yikes. Like, what the fuck? It's because Canada's just so big and empty. It just costs a lot to fly there. Whereas, I could get a flight to Taipei for like $200, you know? So it's like, oh, well, I guess I'm not going home yet. I think I'll hit up Taipei and then, I don't know, I could go to Vietnam. Then I could make my way over to Europe, go back to Amsterdam, or finally try France, maybe. Utilise un peu de mon français. Parle français avec les francophones de Paris. But yeah, Busan's real nice. And man, there's these mountains that are really accessible. My Airbnb is like right in the center of town. And yet, I haven't even taken the subway yet because you can just walk. It's a small enough city that you can just walk wherever. So I'm at this big mountain range that's maybe a 90-minute walk to get here. Not that bad. And I've been doing like one day on, one day off. One day of exploring, and then the next day just go to a coffee shop and chill out. Man, coffee shop culture here is awesome because there's so many coffee shops. It's absolutely crazy. The way there are convenience stores, like on every block in Japan, here there's some convenience stores, not as many as that. Here it's coffee shops. There's literally a coffee shop on every block, at least, probably multiple. So you never really have a problem finding somewhere to sit down. And yeah, like people are just there all day with their laptops out doing work. It's just totally the culture here is you just go to the coffee shop and you fucking chill out all day. It's very comfortable. But yeah, I was walking on these mountains a couple days ago. And it was getting to be a little late in the day, but I realized there was more to go. You could keep going along the ridge for another 5 kilometers or something. So I was like, yeah, today I'll do that. I'll go continue that journey. But now that I'm doing it, it's like, oh yeah, that did take me all day though to get to that point. And this mountain is like 650 meters. And the mountains here feel a lot larger because, you know, I guess they measure mountains by sea level. So since this is a coastal town, the town itself is a lot closer to sea level, I presume. Because, yeah, I was at that, like, 400-meter mountain in Jecheon, and it didn't feel like that big a deal. Being on a 400-meter mountain here feels like a 400-meter mountain. And this one here is, like, 650. Like, when I got home from hiking up this thing, I just had to lie down for fucking half an hour. I, like, couldn't move. It's just like, oh. Because it's neat that it's here and it's like two neighborhoods away and it's so nice and convenient. It's just in your backyard. It's still a fucking mountain. So now that I'm here, I'm sort of a third of the way up. Maybe it was a little presumptuous of me to be like, oh, I'll just go even further. Because it was a whole adventure just to get to where I was the other day. Maybe I need to chill a little. I'm pushing it. Pushing it a little hard. Anyway, that's the travel update. Busan's going well. I like it. I recommend it. If you're ever visiting South Korea, I mean, I guess Seoul is worth... it's worth stopping by. It's something to see. I don't know. I think if you like New York, you might like it. But the coastal vibe, the Busan vibe, is a lot more Fukuoka-y or Vancouver-y, and that's much more my vibe. I like this a lot better. And yeah, I presume I'll be here for a while. I wonder, I'm getting pretty close to the end of this book. Where will I be when I finish the first draft? It might even be here. It's so cool, I don't know if I mentioned this, but unexpectedly, I didn't know this was a thing till I came here. Most visitor visas for most countries seem to be 90 days. And it's the same in South Korea. Most countries get 90 days. But Canadians get 180 days, and I couldn't figure out any reason why, and we seem to be the only country that does. And it's so nice. What a nice bonus. I think we've earned it. Canadians, man, we're pretty fucking good. You're not gonna have a lot of trouble with a Canadian, probably. I mean, in Japan, you can technically stay for 290 days, but it's like a lot more awkward and unspoken and weird. It's technically 90 days, and then you can probably go back, but it's nice that it's on the books here. It's so nice and easy to just really stay for a long time. I appreciate it. Finally, being Canadian is paying off. All these years of smiling and being polite and nice and building up the reputation of like, oh yeah, everyone likes Canadians, but what do we get out of it? Fucking nothing. But South Korea, they recognize, maybe it's because they love Anne of Green Gables so much. They're like, hey, if you're the kin of Anne, hell yeah, you can stay. Coming towards some manner of little river passing between two mountains. But all right, that's the travel yammering. Now let's do some book yammering. So last episode I mentioned that Brianna Mariah's book Transitus came out, and it was just the EPUB when I put out that episode, but now you can get the full book. The full book is available if you want to order a sweet hardcover. I, of course, would have been an ebook man no matter what, because I don't buy nothing. Everything I own fits in a book bag. I got no room for books, but that's the beauty of the digital world, is I think I'm 5 or 6 chapters in, and I just read a chapter once in a while. I'll probably read one today. Just stop somewhere. That's what I gotta do. I gotta, instead of going farther, just hiking farther every day, if anything, I should be hiking less. I need to stop more often. I'll stop halfway up this mountain and read a chapter so as not to kill myself. But I got some stuff to yammer about, things, little things that made me think of, compare and contrast, writerly stuff. One thing is, the blurb I read last episode wasn't the actual proper back of the book blurb, it was just an extra bit in the email from her mailing list. So that was kind of interesting for two reasons, I guess. You could take it as that you kind of can't underestimate how dumb your readers might be. I'll take myself as a great example. Didn't even occur to me. You might have something that seems very obvious, but it's probably not the worst idea to presume people aren't gonna understand things and they're just gonna take things the wrong way and be dumb. Because I read the wrong blurb. However, on the other side of that, I guess I read the wrong blurb because I didn't like examine the order page for the book. I just went to order it. You know, I'm pre-sold. The blurb could have been a direct insult against me, and I still would have ordered it, you know? So it doesn't really matter that I didn't read the proper blurb, because I didn't need the, there's a bunch of people. I was just thinking how it's so weird that there's nobody here, but there's a bunch of people. Anyway, yeah, I didn't need the proper blurb. I didn't need to be sold, so it doesn't actually matter that I read the wrong one. Oh yeah, I see. There's sort of a proper waterfall here and there's benches and stuff. Everyone is congregating, so let me take a little side route to avoid them for a moment because, yeah, the little blurb I read last episode was more like a tone piece where the proper back of the book summary is a lot clearer about the actual plot, and it's cool. When I was reading this, I was like, oh yeah, this sounds exciting. If I hadn't already bought the book, I think this would help push me to buy the book, so let's do it. Let's do the In a World voice this time. Let's do it like movie trailer time. It's 22:50. Wait, let me get real in close. Let's do this aggressive voiceover time, super close to the microphone. It's 22:50. Ice caps have melted. The world is under one unifying government, and humans have a genetic equal, Homo transitus. Forced into exile for their differences, transitus families have only one place to live considered safe, the sweltering community of an East Antarctic island. Here, transitus kids train for a life of living in the ocean, because one day, their lungs will no longer breathe air. For 19-year-old Crimsy Anosh, this time has come. When his little sister Alpita goes missing, Crimsy has only 24 hours to rescue her before his lungs change. Lamia Karuli, the island's president, also feels time running out, for reasons kept closely guarded. Decades deep in illegal genetic experiments, her actions endanger the very existence of transitus society under her rule and transitus kind. Searching for his sister, Crimsy stands against a plot that threatens to destroy life on the island for both humans and transitus. As his transition looms, reality hits. Saving Alpita before his body betrays him may not be possible. Soon he'll have to take that first shocking breath of ocean and accept what comes next.
Sounds cool, right? And it is. So that's what I've noticed so far in this first handful of chapters. I'll just talk about it in relation to my book, Compare and Contrast, because hey, why not? What else am I going to talk about? This whole fucking podcast is about my stupid book, so apologies for making it so egocentric, but it's just how I thought about it. As I'm reading, I'm always thinking about what I'm working on compared to whatever I'm reading. Transitus is a lot more complicated, like a lot more characters. And at first I was having a little bit of a hard time keeping track of who's exactly who, until I just kind of gave up on that, and that worked out fine. It's like, you know, maybe I don't need to remember exactly everybody's name and exactly where they sit, because it'll just sink in as I go. And that does seem to be the case. Like at this very moment, there's the researcher who's the daughter of the woman who runs the Antarctic island with the illegal genetic research. I can't tell you her name off the top of my head. There's her coworker. I can't tell you her name off the top of my head. I remember Crimsy because I just read that that blurb, but I've remembered probably. The cool, gender non-conforming, like cool character who they thought wasn't gonna transition, but then turned out to be viable for transition. That character's really cool. What's their name? I bet I can remember. Zeph, haha, see? So it's all sinking in, like as I go, it'll all sink in more. I kind of had to like just tell myself to relax about it. Like, don't worry about it if you don't exactly remember exactly every little detail of exactly who everybody is. It'll be fine. Right by the waterfall, there is a path you could kind of scramble up to, a much more indistinct path. That's what I did the other day when I was here. But not today. Today I'm just going to follow this proper path that all the locals are walking and just see where it goes. Got to take this easy. There's no need to go straight up a mountain. There's probably much easier paths that I'm not taking. And then if this takes me somewhere else, that's fine. Who cares? But yeah, I thought that could be an interesting thing for me to keep in mind, even with my own writing, is that I probably shouldn't worry too much about having a lot of characters or if things being a little complex, because it all just settles in your mind anyway. Because I really, I really do keep my stuff like really small, really contained. Like the novel Explode I'm always yammering about on this podcast, it's essentially two characters. Eventually it becomes a third. But that's about it, and I've got all kinds of stories that are like that are really just about two people for an entire novel. And that's fine too. I mean, maybe that'll just be my style. Maybe that's just what I do. But I think that comes into more than just writing. Like, I just like things to be very contained. Like, I was thinking how that's one reason I like traveling so much. I love this little Airbnb room I've got, just every little thing in it that I've just got exactly what I need, and everything that I need is there, and I don't have any extra stuff. And I like that feeling. It's like, this is just what I need. And I even kind of like traveling to countries where I don't speak the language because it simplifies things. It feels like in a video game when you walk along and you can only go in the occasional building. The rest are just storefronts that you can't get in because they can't program every single building. And that's how it feels here and in Japan, in both places, where it's just when I walk down the street, there's like, you know, 99 out of 100 buildings that they're just inaccessible to me. It's like, I don't even know what that place is. I know the basics. I know the convenience stores and I know simple little things. I can go here, I can go there, I can go to the dollar store, I can go to Burger King, but most of the stuff is just not accessible to me. And I even like, you know, that just like the advertising that's everywhere, you know, on just every little sign and every little corner and every little magazine and every little placemat and every little everything has writing on it that you just kind of can't help but read. And here, just my eyes just, they just glide over it. Like, here's the sign in this park. Busan Infrastructure Corporation, I can read. The rest of it, who knows? Who knows what this says? If it was something important, you know, they would have something to make it obvious that, hey, you should get out your Google Translate because this is something important. This isn't, though. This is just whatever. Park Association stuff. And I just like the simplicity of, like, it just, my eyes just slide right past, and that's that. So it could just be a style thing. Maybe that's just what I like. Maybe that's just how I'm always going to do stuff. But yeah, that's definitely a difference. Man, my stuff is simple. It's like, man, you better like these two characters, because this is it. This is all I got for you. And also just, I guess, it kind of ties into that back of the book summary. Just even the feeling of like a proper plot, of like proper action happening, and there being stuff going on and bigger events, and like that exciting feeling of like, hey, stuff, holy crap, a plot that is like actually going to develop. It's so weird in some ways. Hopefully, again, it's just an endearing quirk, but it's just weird how I like aggressively don't do that. I call the book Explode, and then we wait 50 chapters of meandering conversations until the fucking place finally explodes. But we knew that was going to happen from the cover, from the name. I'm not saying that's a good or bad thing. I'm not planning to change my style at this juncture, but it's something to keep in mind in the future of like, oh yeah, you know, it is kind of exciting though to have a story that is like an actual story. What an interesting concept. Maybe in the future, you know, I'll keep that tucked away in my mind. Oh, here's more people coming up ahead of me. I mean, that's one bonus to just hiking up through the vague trail in the mountains, is there's not people all the time. When you're on the proper path, there are people all the time. But yeah, those are just some random initial thoughts, but I also just wanted to read the proper book blurb and yeah, once again, recommend that you go grab a copy of Transitus by Brianna Mariah. Oh yeah, that's another thing that I thought of, that stylistically, this again just made me think of something that happened to me, but I don't think is what happened in her case, is stylistically she has a lot of very small paragraphs. And I remember that happened to me inadvertently in my Last of Us book, because I literally wrote that entire book on an antiquated Droid phone from like 2010. So I was writing it on a very tiny screen, and the size of the screen I was writing on caused me to make much smaller paragraphs because I just wanted them to fit on the tiny screen. And I remember at the end, after the first draft was done, and I moved the whole thing onto a desktop computer, and then I saw it and I was like, wow, it's so strange that there's so many paragraph breaks. And then I kind of reworked it on the next run through and made them into longer paragraphs and stuff. But in my case, it really was just a function of the actual screen I was writing on changed how I wrote, which I thought, like, what a strange thing. That's interesting. But in Brianna's case, I don't think that's happening because, from what I recall, she writes, you know, on a laptop or on a proper computer, not on a tiny phone, not on a tiny telephone screen. So I think in that case, it's just, that's just her style. That's just how she likes to write. But it did make me think of that, just a little phenomenon I'd forgotten about. That is just kind of interesting. That the medium changes, can change how you present stuff. Because I suppose it would probably be the opposite with people who write their first drafts with audio. That's still a phenomenon that I've danced around a little. Seems interesting. Like, what if I yammered out a chapter of a book while I was hiking up this mountain? It never really worked for me, but who knows, maybe someday, but I don't think my brain quite works that way. But then presumably if you did that, you would just have a fucking big batch of text, right? Or if your software took all your pauses to mean paragraph break, maybe you'd have the same problem. Maybe just paragraph breaks all over the place. I don't know. That's just speculation, but yeah, I don't know. Interesting that just the way, I'm sure I brought this up before, but even just the fact that we have word processing now and that you can so easily re-edit stuff. What a magical world, because I always think of the tale of Ayn Rand writing Atlas Shrugged, one of the largest novels of all time. Writing it in the 40s and the 50s with typewriters. So if she changed some stuff, it had to be retyped. Everything had to be retyped from that point on. It's like, what a fucking nightmare. You know, that would really cause me to want to pick the right words the first time through. How many times can you retype a chapter just to make a tiny change? We live in a fucking world of luxury compared to that shit. But I presume it's going to be a similar thing this time. I'm still writing mostly on a phone, a slightly bigger, higher resolution phone now. But I bet when I get this whole thing, this first draft done, and I move it onto a bigger screen, onto a proper computer screen, it's just going to visually look different than I expect. That's going to be a whole, man, there's so many other things, like editing, publishing, oh my God. I mean, obviously I'll keep kind of chronicling stuff, but this is how to write a novel, not how to fucking edit a novel, not how to publish a novel. Once I get to the end of this first draft, I'm going to consider the mission statement of this podcast complete. This is the part that I was confident I could get to the end of, that I had something useful to say. I didn't expect it to take this long, but I knew I'd make it to the end, and I'm like, I'm going to chronicle that. That could be handy to someone. After this first draft is done, though, fuck if I know, dude. Uncharted territory. I'll keep chronicling the process, but that's a good point to stop listening to me, because I won't know what the fuck I'm doing. But yeah, there's some random thoughts. Go grab Transitus, Brianna Mariah. Available at all fine booksellers and now available as a for real book on paper and everything. And the other thing I had on my mind that I wanted to talk about was the idea of, I had some thoughts about song lyrics and the idea of writing stuff that's specific versus general through the medium of Elliott Smith songs, but I don't think I want to talk about that while I'm walking up a hill. I don't think I want to talk about anything while I'm walking up a hill. I'm just always walking up a hill. But let's wait till until I'm either walking across a hill or possibly down a hill. This path, though, I took
this is leading me up to the peak. But yeah, with a nice, they have these, on the major hiking paths in Korea, they have these in Seoul and Jecheon and Busan, so they're everywhere. Is they oftentimes have this like woven, it's like a little rug that I'm not exactly sure what it's made of. I don't know if it's straw or what. It seems pretty organic-y, like it seems to match with the outdoors. It's not like they just laid a rug down in the middle of nature. But it's very much like a rug, and it just makes it really easy to know that you're on the right trail. And to help your grippers keep their grip. Yeah, the trail systems are so well delineated and so well marked in South Korea. I think it's a good lesson to learn for me is stop going off the trail. Stop trying to take a shortcut. It's not easier. And if you just go the way everybody else is going, how's that for a metaphor for life? It's not the worst thing you can do. Sometimes it's better. Maybe everybody else is going that way because it actually is the right way to go, huh? How about that? But all right, let's tune back in when I'm no longer actively hiking upward. All right, it's the next day. I'm in a different part of Busan now. Yesterday, I only made it like halfway up the mountain, but the path I was on was real nice. It like went around the outside edge of the mountain. And I got a really nice view of one of the lakes. It was pretty cool. And that was definitely more than enough, because one sneaky thing about Busan, there are so many mountains in this region of the world that a lot of times climbing a mountain, it's like a pretty discreet activity. You get to the mountain, you climb up the mountain, and that's it. And it's like, yeah, I did it. And like Okutama, Japan, some of the mountains were so steep that it triggered my fear of heights, which I usually don't feel on mountains. But they were so severe that it was like I was clinging to the side of a building. It was terrifying. Where Busan, I guess because it's by the sea, it's more like Fukuoka, where the mountains are a lot more gradual. But that's also sneaky, because like I was just so out of energy yesterday. It was crazy. And that's happened to me twice in a row on that mountain. It's not a small mountain, it's like 650 meters. But that's not unusual. I can do that, I hike that all the time. But I realized as I was walking home that I don't even really need to use Google Maps because I can just go downhill. Anytime I'm walking through the city on the way back and I get to an intersection, all I need to do is take whatever way is going downhill. And I just keep funneling downhill until I finally get to this big expressway overpass thing. And I know that I need to follow that to get back to my Airbnb. But then I realized, like, oh, wait a second. If I'm walking downhill all the way back, then without noticing, I was also walking uphill the whole way there. So I'm walking like 90 minutes just to get to the start of this mountain. But it's uphill that whole way, you know? It's like sneakily uphill. I don't really notice at that point that I'm going uphill, but I am. So I start off already at a pretty significant energy deficit and then try to climb the mountain, which is, you know, much more severe. And yeah, it's like, whew, mercy. It is like this weird level of tiredness that it's like, dude, I've been like hiking up mountains for months now between Korea and Japan. I'm getting good at it. I feel like my cardio is good. My leg muscles are fucking awesome. Why is Busan fucking me so hard? And that's why. Sneaky elevation. It sneakily wears you down. So yeah, I just need to keep that in mind and maybe take things a little lighter, have lighter expectations for what I can do in the day. Or, I mean, usually in Japan, and definitely in Seoul, I always took subways to the mountains, or trains. I haven't done that at all here, but that's another possibility. Just to get to the base of the mountain
a little more daisy fresh. But whatever, we'll see. Yesterday was fine. Like, I didn't need to go to the top. I've already been to the top. It was kind of cool to just go halfway up, see a different view, have a different little experience. But all right, to wrap this episode up, this is just a little thing I had on my mind. It's a little bit abstract, but I think it'll relate. Where I was just listening to Elliott Smith, he's one of my favorite musicians, but I only learned of him when he sadly passed away in 2003. That's how I heard of him. I was like, who's this Elliott Smith guy everybody on LiveJournal is talking about? I put on his album XO, and the first song is called Sweet Adeline. Not that Sweet Adeline, it's his own song. But immediately, just after one listen, it was one of those rare times where something doesn't need to grow on you. You don't need to, like, let it sink in. Just immediately, right away, I was like, this is fucking amazing. This is one of the coolest songs I've ever heard. And then Elliott Smith's overall stuff, you know, I'm more 50-50 on, but the 50% that I really like is ludicrous how good it is. But then it's weird because from that point on, since I started at the point that the poor guy died, there was never anything new, you know? It's just how deep can you dig into what exists. But you can dig really deep. There is a lot of Elliott Smith stuff. And one cool thing is that it's pretty easy to find early versions of a lot of his songs, early demos, that very often have different lyrics. And there's a pretty common phenomenon that happens with his lyrics. I think I've heard him actually comment on this specifically in interviews, but I can't say precisely where I might have heard that. But I think this could relate to writing, because I was thinking about how the novel I'm writing, I did have an ending in mind, because not having a clear ending does not work for me. It just leads me to, leads a project to unravel, and I can't finish. It's too hard to tie together all the disparate themes and stuff into something that is coherent and makes any kind of fucking sense at the end. I just can't do that. I need to know from the outset where I'm going. However, then where I end up might be pretty different, which is the case in this novel. It's the same technical ending, but I've talked about this in many episodes, that the tone keeps changing. The tone keeps softening specifically. Softer and softer and softer and softer. And now that I'm right there, I'm right at the end. Even in these little moment to moments that I'm still working my way through. Like, I just wrote a little scene where Surratt is exiting the station. And before she became simpatico with the sentient part of the station itself, she couldn't do anything. She couldn't open a door by herself. Now she's exiting, you know, flying away in this little pod, and she's just thinking about how impossible this would be if she didn't have the help of the station itself. She'd just be trapped. And she sends a little message to the station and just says thank you, and it doesn't respond. Maybe because it doesn't understand, maybe because it's busy. It's an alien thing, so I often have it sort of not respond or behave a little oddly. And she doesn't mind, she doesn't care, she's not expecting an answer. But even just little moments like that, you know, it was inconceivable at the outset when I thought she was going to be like a pillaging barbarian at the end of this story, that she'd just have a quiet moment to thank something or someone. So I want to talk about how Elliott Smith does that with his song lyrics, because not only, I mean, I always think with music, it is the music itself that stands out the most to me. I think if you didn't speak English, you would really still find Elliott Smith's songs extremely interesting. He just does stuff that other people don't do. But the lyrics also, as a nice bonus, are extremely good, super evocative. He's an extremely good writer. And it might seem like song lyrics maybe don't necessarily tie in so much to a prose novel, to a fiction novel. It maybe ties in more to, like, poetry, but I have been surprised to learn that some poets actually listen to this show, more than I expected, which I expected zero. So glad to have you here. But I think it might fit also because just the way that I write, I'm really not concerned, like I was saying earlier in the episode, that I just don't really focus on plot, on the nuts and bolts of what's happening, the A to B to C to D. I'm much more interested in tone because I find that's how I feel with other stuff when I'm watching a movie or reading a book. If the tone, like if a story can hit a tone that I like, that I resonate with, some pretty weird stuff can happen in that story. And if it feels tonally appropriate, I'm willing to roll with it. Whereas if somebody loses the tone, if something tonally jarring happens or something, if the tone shifts in a way where I feel like like the writer is kind of lacking in emotional intelligence, like how did you let that happen? How did you not see that that's throwing off the vibe? You know, that's so much more destructive to me than any plot problem ever could be. I'm super invested in tone, which in some ways I think maybe is more like a poem or like song lyrics. I'm just, you know, doing that to the nth degree in this great, big, gigantic, huge novel. But I still want the whole thing to feel like a song, you know? Maybe you don't know, but that's how I feel. So I think I can kind of like identify more with or kind of get more out of the example of a lyricist like Elliott Smith than I would out of. That's why this podcast has never been, you know, I've had people send that message to me before of like, yeah, I clicked on this how to write a novel expecting the thing you get in all the other writing podcasts, which is like, here's how to construct this, here's how to do this, here's how to world build, here's the character introduction to the blah, 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 you know. The joke version is the hero's journey. I remember that was a somewhat unique thing people would bring up way back in the day. Joseph Campbell, the hero's journey, you know, that's how Star Wars was developed. Man, if anyone ever says the hero's journey to you nowadays, run screaming the other way. What more boring a thing could anyone ever reference or talk about? Who the fuck cares? You know, we've been on the hero's journey a million times, and I'm not exaggerating, a million times through different mediums and stories. Nobody needs that anymore. It's not interesting. Uh-oh, I'm coming to the edge of this mountain. That's right, I've been on this trail before, but I thought it was a little longer than this. Shucks, because from here, it's actually kind of a major highway. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm literally going to turn around, go back the exact way that I came, because where I'm ultimately trying to get to is Adia Coffee, my favorite South Korean coffee chain, because they have a self-serve machine that not only has English menus, but accepts my weird Visa debit card, my foreign Visa debit thing. So I like it because I can just order such weird stuff. I can have these complicated weird orders that I not only wouldn't do here, because if you happen to get an employee who is not great at English, I feel bad putting them through that. But I wouldn't do that in North America either. I was a barista for years and years and years. When you get the person who requests the latte at a specific temperature and wants velvety foam and all kinds of other fucking douchebag shit, if that's you, fucking quit it, asshole. Fuck off with that. Just order a latte and shut up. But if you're doing it through a dumb machine, hey, whatever, then why not? Explore the menu, see what weird stuff's in there. Because that's fun even at like McDonald's and stuff. You can just order stuff that you might not know is even a thing. So yeah, what often happens with Elliott Smith lyrics is that the early versions are much more specific and pointed and generally kind of harsh and brutal. And then as he revises the song, sometimes in some cases you can hear like different live performances throughout the years and see multiple iterations because a lot of times he didn't put out songs as proper album tracks until he'd been performing them live for years. And I think it's so neat because it seems like such a good technique, and it really, like, again, reminds me of what happened with this book, where I had the harsh version because I had the feeling I wanted to hang on to. What's the important feeling? And in the case of this novel, it was being trapped on an alien space station and feeling that trapped xenophobia of, I don't fit in here, I don't understand this place or these people. And not only do I not now, I never will. And that's the feeling that informed all of the early parts of the novel. Then by the end, you know, different things arose. But that was the important initial feeling. And it seems that way with Elliott Smith lyrics also, where he'll talk about something that was happening in his life. And unfortunately, he had quite a troubled life, so some of this stuff is kind of harsh. Because that's the feeling, that's the tone. But then once he got the song down musically, he would often change the lyrics to something more general and more poetic, less specific. And I think it really did help because, I don't know, it's interesting. There's two sides to it, because the hyper-specific references are identifiable, and I can say, like, oh yeah, I get what he's saying, I get where he's coming from. But it's so specific that it's like, it's the kind of thing that would be uncomfortable to listen to 200 times, because it is so specific and so personal and so clearly about him and not about you, the listener. Where when he shifts things to a more general style of lyric, it makes it that much easier to listen to the song 200 times and for it to apply to different elements of your life and different times in your life and different aspects of what's going on with you. And I got some examples, just stuff that popped up as I was listening through this big batch of Elliott Smith rarities. And I've heard all these before, but it's been a little while, and yeah, they just really stood out this time. So as a small example, there's a song called Junk Bond Trader. If you want to hear any of these, it's pretty easy to find, I think just on YouTube. You can find the main versions really easily, but if you just type in alternate lyrics, this is all quite well archived stuff, not hard to find. In Junk Bond Trader, the original version had the lyric, "The first true love failed because you felt too much." And I really do like that lyric because I can really identify with that. You know, the first true love, I still think of my first girlfriend that I met in Vancouver. A little late to the dating game, I was already getting into my 20s. But I really did, I really did try hard to maintain that relationship. And then for years and years after, I was always like, nobody was better than her, she was the best. I wish I had tried a little harder. And then eventually, as more years pass, you think back more and you're like, oh, actually though, I really am forgetting about X, Y, and Z. Even though I was like 24, emotionally I was probably about 16 at a push. It's not surprising that it didn't last. But saying it failed because you felt too much, super duper relatable. I was like too invested. I mean, we both kind of were. We had this like radical honesty thing going on. Communication's everything. Where I think these days, I'm much more a fan of the lighter touch, the laissez-faire relationship, the live and let live. You don't have to be wicked codependent on every stupid level. But it's because I felt too much. I thought it was too important. Made everything too intense. So it's still a very good lyric. And these examples, they go from, I've only got three examples here, and they go from slightest to most different. So this one is a very slight change. But in the final version, instead of the first true love failed because you felt too much, it's the first true love folded at the slightest touch. And that's so cool because it does just open it up a little bit. It's the same idea, but it's a much more evocative image. Like a house of cards, you know, and you just touch it a little bit. And then you realize this thing you thought was so sturdy and so strong. Oh, you just touch it a little. Whoops. Whoops. It reminds me of the Linkin Park lyric about how when the page is crumpled up, it can't be flat again. I always think of that yeah, once you crumple up a piece of paper, you just can't flatten it out again. Things are not going to go back to how they were. You know, you just, some things are irreversible. And in the junk bond trader example, I just like it because failed because you felt too much also kind of has that smacks of emo. You know, it does have a bit of that, like, self, what's the right word for it? Like, I don't know, like you're almost proud that it failed because you felt too much. You didn't do anything wrong. If anything, you did everything too right. You were trying too hard. You were too invested. You were too excellent. You were too amazing. You felt too much and it didn't work. And it's like, yeah, no, probably you were a fucking overbearing dickbag and you just didn't understand because you didn't have enough experience to know how things are supposed to work. Folded at the slightest touch is a lot less, you know, it doesn't have that weird tone of almost being weirdly congratulatory. It's just more a statement of just, here's what happened, here's how it was. And again, I feel like this is maybe a quite a neutral example. I feel like both versions are fine. But I do like the second version better, the folded at the slightest touch version. If I'm going to listen to a song, you know, I say 200 times, but realistically, it's like, geez, I must be up to 800 or 900 with that song, easy. I like the second version better. And another example that surprised me is this song Coast to Coast, which is one of my very favorite Elliott Smith songs. That I'll start with the final, more general lyric first in this case, where it's, if you can't help it, leave it alone. Coast to coast, coast to coast. You know, it's not very specific. If you can't help it, just leave it alone. Coast to coast, coast to coast. And that song always stood out to me, especially because that was right when I moved from the East Coast to the West Coast. That was on his posthumous album, the first track. So it just had extra, like, coast to coast meaning for me. But I was surprised to hear an early version, and especially in his later work. You know, there was a lot of recurring stuff about, you know, he's a fairly, emotionally unstable guy, I guess you'd say, with different substance abuse problems. And many stories about different friend groups, and like, we tried to help this guy, and basically, that just led to us not being his friend anymore, and he'd move on to the new friend group in a different city, and that would kind of happen again. And then eventually his death was an accident, but basically a suicide. Or, if not a suicide, just he was in a state, you know, in a state where he was just really acting out in dangerous ways, and he ended up stabbing himself to death. So the original version of Coast to Coast, instead of if you can't help it, leave it alone, it's if you can't help me, just leave me alone. And it's a little difference, but I was like, oh geez, I don't know, it kind of hit me, because I'm like, I didn't know that one. I guess I'd never heard until just now, I'd never heard that early version of Coast to Coast. And instead of Coast to Coast, he says go home. If you can't help me, then just leave me alone. Go home. Go home. And it's just like, yeah, so much more like, get out of here, get out of my face. And I was like, wow, weird. I didn't know that's how that song used to go. But again, I feel like he knew that if he put out the song as, if you can't help me, leave me alone, you know, the way a song is, it's not just his own personal thing, it's for an audience. And I think he knew for a mass audience to listen to this song over and over for years and years, maybe it's best if it's not so directly about him. You know, if you can't help it, leave it alone. It's very easy to apply to many situations and many relationships that many types of people might have in life. If you can't help me, leave me alone, go home. You know, really just makes you think about him and the problems he was having specifically with people in his life. And anyone who followed his career and knew about him would know that's what it was about. And it just shrinks down the scope. Instead of it being about you, the listener, and what you identify with and what you're going through, it would just be about him. And my last example is the song Everybody Cares, Everybody Understands, which I'll read the original lyrics first, which these are some of the most direct, most pointed lyrics in any of his songs. So it's quite shocking to learn that there was an even more pointed, more direct version before this. Because this is from the album EXO, which is mostly non-specific, you know, mostly quite poetic. So this one moment really does stand out on the album, where the lyric is, "You say you mean well, you don't know what you mean. Fucking oughta stay the hell away from things you know nothing about." Which sounds like that should be the early version, right? You say you mean well, you don't know what you mean. Fucking oughta stay the hell away from things you know nothing about. You know, that's very clearly about those same situations that I was talking about before. People trying to have interventions and people trying to help them. Fucking stay the hell away from things that you know nothing about. You say you mean well, you don't know what you mean. But the original version of that song, man, it is off the deep end. It is ludicrous. Where again, I think the idea was just hold on to the feeling that he's trying to express. Hold on to the thing that was on his mind at the time and just say it directly. Get it down there. Write the song that sounds like this. And the original version is, "The dream-killing doctor says to describe my dream. But some things are for no one to know, and you, 12-stepping cop, to not find out." It's weird that that even fits into the cadence of the song. "The dream-killing doctor says to describe my dream. But some things are for no one to know, and you, 12-stepping cop, to not find out." It's like, Jesus Christ, tell me what you really think, Elliot. Holy fuck. The dream-killing doctor, the 12-stepping cop. Man, like so ludicrously aggressive. How dare you ask me to describe my dreams? How dare you ask me to describe my feelings? How dare you ask me to describe my life? Especially you. You probably don't even do drugs. You probably don't even drink to excess, you 12-stepping cop. And there's also lyrics in there about him being followed, which was a big thing. He was very paranoid at the time. He thought people from his record label were following him. You know, he's a troubled man. But even in that case, I think that's so interesting that the final version, I mean, it's quite a moment on the album. It does stand out. "Fucking oughta stay the hell away from things you know nothing about." Because it's the one part that you're just like, fuck. He's not being fancy anymore. He's telling you to fucking stay away from his fucking life. But it could have been so much more direct. And that one is beyond emo. Like, it's like an angry teenager. 12-stepping cops, dream-killing doctors, fuck you, mom. You know, it's like bordering on ridiculous. But because he did this so often, and this happened so much in his work, I don't think he ever really expected that to be the version of the song. I don't think he ever thought that was going to be how it goes. But it's kind of cool. It's a cool technique that he was, like, confident enough in his songwriting process to do that, to like, let's not try to be super genius, mega fancy Elliott Smith out the gate. This is just, you know, we're just figuring out this song. We're getting there. And it helps to help us get there. The first version can be exactly what's on my mind right now. Exactly what I was thinking about while I was trying to write this song. Because it's weird, like everybody cares, everybody understands. It is kind of a gentle song, a lot of piano. XO is when he kind of became more electric. He started off in sort of a hardcore band. Then he became mega acoustic. And this was his kind of return to electric guitars and stuff, but it's still not like a very harsh album. And that's a very pretty song. It's not a harsh song musically. But it's definitely the difference between a standout moment, you know, a real jab of a moment that makes you kind of sit up a little, fucking ought to stay the hell away from things you know nothing about. You're like, huh, I didn't expect that to come out of this song or this album. As opposed to if it had been the dream-killing doctor, the 12-stepping cop. I mean, at that point, you could just name the song, Everybody Suck My Dick. You know, it would have, instead of being this cool, unexpected, harsh, spiky moment in the album, it would have been just like a pit, like a weird pothole that you hit and you got to shake it off. Like, ooh, what was that? So I know this was a bit of an odd topic, but I hope that was interesting. And again, these are all great songs. I recommend, if you don't know them, go check them out. Junk Bond Trader, Coast to Coast, Everybody Cares, Everybody Understands. And now for song of the day, of course, let's play an Elliott Smith song. Let's play a song that it doesn't necessarily fit with that pattern, but it's also, it sort of does, and it's just an interesting thing that this song, I've just been obsessed with this song since the first time I heard it. I heard it on a bootleg, kind of a not great quality bootleg recording, and this song was the one that stood out the most. So I went and got the album. It's on Figure Eight, which is not my favorite Elliott Smith album, but the highs are extremely high. It's the song Happiness. And what I think is cool about this song is this is like a weird example of both things, of the general and the specific at the same time. Because the second half of the song, it's like a mantra. It's just him sort of chanting the same phrase over and over again. So the phrase is quite general. It's, all I used to be will pass away, and then you'll see that all I want now is happiness for you and me. Which could mean anything. It could be about anybody. Every time I hear it, I think of something different or someone different. So it's got the general covered, but it's got the specific covered in the sense that for the second half of the song, that's it. He just says that over and over and over and over. And it's one of those things that's like a weird little, I don't know, it's like a test. A test you can do to see how well rested you are or how emotional you're feeling. If you sing along to this song and you just say those words over and over and over again, what I used to be will pass away, and then you'll see that all I want now is happiness for you and me. What I used to be will pass away, and then you'll see that all I want now is happiness for you and me. And just see how many times you can make it through the mantra before you get choked up. Ugh, I wouldn't have made it through a third one. It's this amazing little weird thing that just, even though it's about a very general, you know, could be about anyone, could be about anything, but just that he knew that, like, I'm just going to hammer on this. I'm just going to keep saying this over and over and over and over. And good luck. Good luck not getting emotional about that. So this is Happiness by Elliott Smith. Thank you for listening. I'll see you next time.
Happiness for you.